So I'm Henry Yu. I'm the principal of St. John's College and also an associate professor in history. So I welcome you all to St. John's College to this event tonight. Just a little word about what St. John's College is. St. John's College was founded by the alumni of St. John's University Shanghai, which was the premier university in China from 1879 until it was closed in 1952. So many of the alumni who actually went from St. John's University to Hong Kong were those who helped found this college to keep alive the spirit of St. John's University Shanghai. So we're very proud to be the legacy of the Johanians. We are at UBC, and I'll just acknowledge that we are on the unceded traditional territory of the Musqueam, the Hong Kong-speaking peoples, and that UBC is on their land and on their territory. This is a great chance to actually get together, and I see many old friends and some new faces as well, to look back at the Umbrella Revolution. And we have three people, all three of whom are Hong Kongers, I guess, to use that term in English. And each of them is going to talk in a different way about what happened in Hong Kong over the last, really getting back even the last year or so, before even the sort of formal protests in the streets began to gain worldwide attention. So I'm going to actually introduce each one in turn. Our first speaker will be Professor Hedy Law, who is an assistant professor of musicology. She received her PhD from the University of Chicago. And even though her research that she did for her dissertation is not specifically tied to Cantonese music, and it may seem, even for herself, far away, she's been very interested in terms of the music in the Umbrella Revolution, and particular some of the Cantonese pop songs and things that were really used to good effect. So I'm going to, with that, let her talk about it. But thank you so much, Hedy, for starting us off tonight.
Thank you very much. Okay. First of all, 恭喜发财, okay, 新年快乐. I'm very happy to see so many of you here. This talk is going to be an elaboration of the talk I gave in the Balcom Museum back in November. So I don't want to have too much overlap, so I try to, we'll see how things go, all right? And, okay, here we go. My talk today elaborates some observations I made about the Umbrella Revolution back in November at the Balcom Museum. I want to share my reflections about the ways music politicized geographic locations and how music maps and remaps the geography of resistance. Let me start with a basic question. What was the Umbrella Revolution? Was it a revolution or was it just a movement? The modern concept of revolution, defined by the historian Hannah Arendt, refers to a course of history that suddenly begins anew. According to her definition, the Occupy Central was not a revolutionary event, for it never gathered the momentum necessary to change either the political reality or the political direction of the history of Hong Kong. Tonight, I borrow from W.J.T. Mitchell's recent study of the global Occupy movement and claim that the Umbrella movement takes on a revolutionary spirit. What follows is an argument structured around three songs: an old Canton pop song composed in the 1990s when Hong Kong was still a British colony, and a new Canton pop song composed for the Umbrella movement, and a birthday song appropriated as a cultural weapon. I choose these three songs not because they were the only ones sung during the period of occupation, but each of them carries distinct theoretical implications. I want to show that music makes the geography of resistance malleable. I want to start our discussion with an incident on October the 22nd. A group of hikers called Hong Kong Spiders hanged a big banner on the Lion Rock Mountain. As opposed to the Victoria Peak on the Hong Kong Island, this Lion Rock Mountain, located between Kowloon and the New Territories, symbolizes the Lion Rock spirit, a sentiment shared in the 1960s and 70s by the lower class and middle class Hong Kong people who believed in hard work and upward mobility. By contrast, the Victoria Peak on the Hong Kong Island sits atop the financial districts and symbolizes colonial elitism. The yellow background of this banner refers to a previous act of defiance. at the official celebration of the National Day of China on the 1st of October, Paul Timmerman, an elected councillor in the Southern District of the Hong Kong Island, carried with him a yellow umbrella and opened it during the ceremony. The color of the umbrella, yellow, presents a sharp contrast against the background of red and black. Red represents China, and black signals the solemnity of the black tie event. Timmerman stood near the back of the hall. He did not intend to be noticed by the dignitaries on stage. He did, however, want to be noticed and pictured by the journalists standing behind him. The next day, a mildly right-wing newspaper, Mingbao, published this picture on the front page, drawing sharp contrast between the lone yellow umbrella inside the hall and the numerous colorful umbrellas outside the hall. The yellow umbrella emerged, therefore, as a revolutionary icon for this movement. The Occupy Lion Rock refers to Timmerman's act of defiance. To drive the revolutionary message home, the banner displays a sentence underneath the umbrella icon. This sentence consists of five Chinese characters translated into English as, "I want a genuine election." By hanging this big banner on the cliff of the Lion Rock Mountain, Hong Kong spiders suggest that the subject pronoun, I, represents the middle or lower class Hong Kong people. This banner was removed the next day. Yet, the removal of this banner did not erase the message it brought forth, nor does it help people forget about the physical effort and specialized skills required to hang this big banner on a cliff. Borrowing the distinction made by the new media theorist Mark Hansen, I claim that a biological experience originally associated with the Occupy Lion Rock had a second life in the virtual world. A video about this act was uploaded to YouTube and was viewed more than 300,000 times in 5 days. Importantly, what makes this Occupy Lion Rock act effective is not just about the message on the banner, but also the interplay between the verbal message and the medium of music. The video shows some unusual properties. One, it does not include any diegetic sound. Two, no one speaks to the camera. There is no narrator. And three, none of the climbers look at the camera. And four, none of them make the classic V-shaped hand gesture that Hong Kong people tend to pose for the camera after a feat like this one. These vocal, facial, and gestural absences indicate that Occupy Lion Rock was not about the climbers themselves, but about the message on the banner. This video is like a silent movie accompanied by music. The editor uses the popular song Boundless Ocean and Sky Hoi Fu Tin Hong as a soundtrack. This song, written in the 1990s by the rock band Beyond, is about the acceptance of challenge in the pursuit of freedom. Note that freedom in this song does not carry any pointed political meaning. The lead singer died in 1993 in Japan, 4 years before the handover. Since then, the rock band was dismantled. The verse and chorus of this song outlines an ascending melodic contour for those of you who don't know this song. The first starts in the low register and ascends in the chorus section. The melody reaches the climax when the singer sings the line, "Sometimes I fear one day I might fall." According to the theory of conceptual mapping developed by cognitive scientists, the verb fall maps onto the melodic peak of the entire song. This mapping forms the sonic analogs of the embodied experience of danger. To highlight these lyrics, the singer adds a short coloratura, drawing attention to the melodic plateau that is out of comfortable vocal range for most male singers. He sounds vulnerable. Video emphasizes this emotional moment, showing a climber trying to get a foothold on that cliff. This frame should be the singularly important one around which other frames were inserted during the editing process, and it has to be a professional editing one. The edited video sends one message. The pursuit of freedom is a high-risk activity. By the time it was uploaded to YouTube later that day, the song carried special political resonance. It was sung in various pro-democratic gatherings in 2014, including the one on September 29th, in which thousands of Hong Kong people rallied around Admiralty the day after the tear gas attack in protest of inappropriate use of violence. This very video, therefore, evokes memories of political solidarity and nostalgia for the colonial Hong Kong. On the surface, Occupy Lion Rock appears to request for a genuine universal suffrage, but the realistic purpose of this Occupy event was to demonstrate how such an act of defiance was possible at all in the midst of political censorship and self-censorship. The viral effect it initiated did not stop at the level of virtual experience, for there was an attempt to retranslate the virtual experience back to the biological realm. A few days after the removal of the banner, a group of Hong Kong long-distance runners responded to the Hong Kong spiders by completing an ultra-marathon of about 106 kilometers, or about 2.5 marathons combined, running around Hong Kong along the route outlining the shape of an umbrella. This shape was recorded by a GPS device worn by one of the runners, and an image of this one, was uploaded to the running group's Facebook page after the fact. The ultramarathon therefore escalated the level of defiance by making the material trace of the umbrella-shaped route unremovable. The issue of materiality is demonstrated in another Canton pop song, Raise the Umbrella. It was composed and recorded pointedly for the umbrella movement by a few popular singers and was uploaded to YouTube on October the 4th, about a week after the tear gas attack. The title, Chang Hei Yu San, Raise the Umbrella, resists neat translation, for the verb chang, meaning to push or to support, is commonly used as a slang in a Cantonese lowbrow spoken language. Unlike the last song that poses registral challenges, this song is utterly accessible, featuring melodic, rhythmic, and harmonic simplicity. Almost any Cantonese speaker can sing this song after hearing it once or twice. This is the chorus. Okay, this is the chorus. Okay, this is a very, very simple song. In the chorus session, two iterations of the stepwise melodic descent of a perfect fourth interval follows the melodic contour of the Cantonese lyrics. It exemplifies the songwriting aesthetic principle called lyric revelation, Lo Ji, a principle that requires the songwriter to compose the melody of Cantonese operas and Canton pops that closely mirrors the tonal contour of the lyrics. Since this song requires good understanding of the spoken Cantonese language and the lowbrow Hong Kong culture, it helps forge the identity of local Hong Kong people as opposed to Mandarin-speaking people, no offense, okay? Whether or not they are Hong Kong residents, in this way, the song brings forth the Cantonese language as the linguistic foundation of a Hong Kong identity. The two phrases, Yat Hei Goi San, Yat Hei Dik Chang, have the same melody, but the rhymes make them slightly asymmetrical. Compared with the word San, the word Chang offers the stress accent to the second phrase, making the first phrase an introduction to the second phrase. The refrain, Yat Hei Goi San, Yat Hei Dik Chang, raise our umbrellas together, support this movement together, therefore, relates the action of raising the umbrella to a pro-democratic political cause. This song served two functions. It pays homage to the iconic Umbrella Man. I'm going to show you. published in The Economist on September 29th, who walk in the midst of tear gas raising the broken umbrella, and also calls for the solidarity of Cantonese-speaking people. The song quickly became the theme song of the movement. It was voted, for example, as one of the most beloved Canton pops of 2014 in the radio commercial. It was quoted on the broadside, showing President Xi Jinping raising a yellow umbrella as if he were to support the pro-democratic umbrella movement. Clearly, it was an instant of provocation and misappropriation. The broadside was removed soon after it was placed there, but the act of removal precisely reveals the effectiveness of this misappropriation. The broadside shows how the umbrella as a revolutionary icon was appropriated in the lyrics, which in turn formed the verbal foundation for another removable aesthetic and political object. The removal of this object from a from a public space in turn confirms the widespread suspicion that freedom of expression in Hong Kong has lost its fundamental legal substance. The intertwined relationship among music, word, image, and material object helps sustain the revolutionary spirit. On the topic of misappropriation, I want to talk about the power of the human voice that turns a politically unmarked place into a revolutionary space. 3 days after the onset of the Occupy movement, on October the 1st, which is also the National Day of China, a subway driver makes the following announcement in the PA system of a train soon after it left the Admiralty Station, which was one of the primary revolutionary sites. He said, Dear students and citizens, thank you for your contribution to this city. We must protect our own city. Not this. What is striking here is not that an announcement came from a machine-like voice, what Hong Kong people like to call a professional voice. Using the professional tone that risks the speaker of any trace of emotional or human agency, the driver performed his pro-protester political position. His voice turns a note of thanks into a political act of defiance. What is remarkable is that this revolutionary voice subsequently turned the train into a revolutionary space. Some of the passengers instantaneously gave the protesters and the drivers, I would suppose, a round of applause. In the Althusserian sense, the driver's voice interpolates the passengers, turning some of them into pro-protester public. The driver's voice, therefore, defies the Occupy movement at site-specific. It shows how the movement metastasized and how it momentarily colonized the supposedly political neutral space. One of the great things about songs is that they are portable. It is fascinating to see how people aestheticize street fights into something musical in a way similar to the gang fight scene in Nana Bernstein's West Side Story. On October the 6th, 2 days after the song Raise the Umbrella was released, protesters in Hong Kong turned a birthday song into a sonic shield. A birthday song joins the instruments of resistance such as umbrella, plastic wrap, and face mask. It added a cultural component to civilian weaponry. Use of something as ubiquitous as a birthday song was yet another instance of misappropriation. the incident originated in a confrontation between protesters and their critics. Someone made a mistake by switching on the birthday song function of a loudspeaker. Within half a minute, protesters appropriated that song and transformed it into a defensive device. As a result, the birthday song was used as a shield that separated protesters from their critics. What was initially a misuse of a device was reappropriated for defense purposes. Note, the peacekeeping property of this reappropriated birthday song comes from the song itself. W.J.T. Mitchell argues that pictures have agency. They want to be addressed. Likewise, some music also has agency. A national anthem of a country creates the sense of belonging to a nation, especially an international event such as the Olympics. While it is true that people make music, it is also true that music can make us do things. The birthday song is an example of this phenomenon. It compels people to sing along and form a celebratory community, and in this case, enlisting singers and listeners as peacekeeping agents. The birthday song, therefore, served the inverse function of tear gas. Where police used tear gas to disperse protesters, the birthday song galvanized them. Looking back at the Umbrella Revolution, I keep thinking about how music marks what I would call the geography of resistance. It would be great to study the soundscape of the Umbrella Revolution and to see how the official media, such as the television or the radio, react against or respond to those revolutionary songs. I want to know how other pieces of music, such as the Chinese national anthem, was deployed as a counter-umbrella instrument. Another area of research is to track uses of this revolutionary song in other places, such as Taiwan, and to see how Canton Pop helped construct political communities and positions in the period leading up to the Kuomintang's historic defeat in the November election. One more promising line of research is to trace the migration of the revolutionary spirit. The singer, Denise Ho, one of the lead singers of the song Raise the Umbrella, was blacklisted pointedly by China for her active involvement in the Umbrella Revolution. In a month from today, she will be singing pop concerts in Taiwan, in Thailand, and Taipei. These concerts, entitled Reimagine Life, look back at the revolution while looking forward to a professional life without the backing of China. Her fans have already shown their support. Tickets were sold out minutes after they were released for sale a few days ago, and an announcement of another concert was made yesterday. I'm interested to see how she puts an anti-counter-umbrella political position to artistic use. Music, I conclude, will continue to carry forward a revolutionary spirit in the post-umbrella period. Thank you.
Our next panelist is Eleanor Yuen. Many of you are familiar with Eleanor as the longtime head of Asian Library at UBC, and she's done much work in also collecting local Chinese-Canadian history as well as other Asian-Canadian histories, and also a strong interest in Hong Kong history. And as one of those who came to Canada from Hong Kong in the last three decades, she's also, I think, a wonderful example of someone who took an interest back in what was going on in Hong Kong, and she's going to speak to us about actually being there in the streets. I don't want to ruin her talk, but let's just say her kids were imploring her not to actually sleep out in the streets. But Eleanor, being a rebellious mother, did not listen to her children.
Why did I become a rebellious mother?
So as she sets up, please do welcome Eleanor Yuen, who I think also, now that it's, in some sense, we're looking back, it perhaps it's a useful moment for Eleanor to tell us what it was like, especially for many of us who were here, away from Hong Kong, to get a sense of what it was like actually in the streets firsthand. And so Eleanor's kindly and generously going to share with us the thing that her kids didn't want her to do. Thanks, Alice.
Thank you, Henry, and thank you everybody for coming to share my experiences and my observation during my 3 week stay in Hong Kong. So my presentation will be very different from Hedy's academic piece. I'm going to talk to you heart to heart and tell you what brought me back to Hong Kong, what I look for when I talk to the students on the street, talk to different people, went to different groups to spend time with them. Although I didn't actually spend a single night in a tent, my daughters keep on calling me to tell me to sleep, you have to go home. Okay, so this is what happened. Now, it's a reflection, so it's a good time to reflect because it has been a few months after the 79 days campaign. And what brought me back was that in retirement, I thought I missed out some of the social movement or activities in Hong Kong while I fought for my career settlement in Canada and so on. So when this happened back in July, I sensed something big is coming up, and I think I don't want to miss it. But it built up a momentum. I just want to see what this campaign is going to be different from the annual parade, the Occupy HSBC 3 years ago, and other protests in Hong Kong in the 17 years after Hong Kong was returned to China. How is it going to be different, and why should we pay attention? And I also was a little suspicious about the ability of the students. I always think that the younger generation in Hong Kong is a little bit spoiled, a little bit often materialistic. I'm sorry, but this is my personal view. And so what these materialistic and hedonic Hong Kong people are going to do for a cause like this, I really would like to see for my own. And the younger generation was very little social consciousness. How can they rally support among themselves, and how they could come together to do something so big? So essentially, I want to see how this is going to unfold, and how would this be different from the other protest. And I also think that at the back of my mind, although universal suffrage seemed to be the main driver of the campaign, if we watch Hong Kong for a long, long time, we know that it may not be the concern of everybody. The bone of contention are very, very different. And how are they different? We saw a lot on the TV, on radio, over social media, and even by hearsay. But I think to see is to have the real impression, and I would think that is the best way to do. And one of the things that always puzzled me was the gap, the parity between the baby boomers and the younger generation. The baby boomers, I belong to the baby boomers, and I believe that many of the problems in Hong Kong stem from the disparity of wealth and power between the younger generation and those in my age. They wield too much power and would not let go, and with power comes with wealth. Other influences as well. So I could understand why younger generation in Hong Kong have grudges against baby boomers, the rich and the powerful. So I would like to go back and talk to them. And in the pictures that I took, I took about 600 of them. And today I picked 60. I don't think I have the time to show you all those 60 pictures that I downloaded. But I took those pictures with all these views, with these concerns in mind. I want to show how these protesters in the street demonstrate their defiance, the sense of humor, their willpower. And And I also would like to talk to people and feel the atmosphere and find out whether the campaign will actually survive Xi Jinping's directive to battle the 7 Western values and institutions at all costs, the 七八准, which including clampdown on democracy, freedom of media freedom, as well as academic freedom. So how would the campaign fare in this kind of atmosphere? And what role will social media and internet play? We know that if you go on to economic journal daily or Apple daily, you can see all the comments back and forth. People unfriend each other or rally support around a certain viewpoint. So how would that impact on the final outcome of the campaign, and how it will empower the younger generation, which has a very strong and very powerful hold on this. And I will also keep an eye on any overseas connection, especially Canadian connections in the protesters. People keep on saying that there is substantial funding from the States, for example. So I would like to see and talk to people and see where they got money for all the limitless resources, truckloads and truckloads of food, supplies, equipment, and so on. Where did they get the money? Is it really from somewhere in outside Hong Kong? Is this the one? Okay. And then the other thing that I looking for is something. Thank you, Andy. Something I'm looking for is the issue of the space. Space in Hong Kong, whether public or private, is astronomically expensive. And what would it mean to have the streets occupied, especially in Central, Admiralty, Causeway Bay? Nobody can imagine. Was a wall of post-it notes and now dubbed as the Lenin Wall. What would it look like? And what did it mean to people on the street, to people who were up against it? And would it give Hong Kong people or participants a new chance to have a new perspective of public space in Hong Kong? So I would like to find out. And then, of course, September 28th came the 87 shots. So I'm more ready to pack, but not yet. And then I went to participate in the protests of Vancouver Society in support of the democratic movement in Vancouver. I saw some friends up there, but not a huge crowd and not really that much support on the other side. And I think if you can afford the time, it's really the time to the moment of Hong Kong that you don't want to miss. Finally, I keep an eye on all the censors that China is putting on Instagram, and many of the terms related to umbrella, such as umbrella, yusan, and chang, and poxun. All these terms were actually censored, and I just could not get into any of the social media related to Hong Kong. Back in China anymore. So, okay, all right. Now, so I went back to Hong Kong and spent 3 weeks. Later on, I'll show you the 60 photos that I took, but let's have the reflection first. It's March 3rd, and then we have a much clearer idea of what they achieved and what they did not achieve. Recently, Hong Kong City University conducted a survey on happiness index. Let me see what they say. The index found out that Hong Kong people were even more unhappy than Singaporeans and people in Japan. As if, you know, the Japanese and Singaporeans should be happier. And it also indicated that Hong Kong people were even unhappier than in 2003 when they went through the SARS period. So it was pretty gloomy, very gloomy, really. And we could see it from time to time. We hear about medium freedom further curtailed, the fate of Hong Kong TV, Wong Wei Gate's Hong Kong TV, the fate, and also how he just marched on without much success. But I watched some of the program. I really appreciate what he did. Bill 23 was back on the table, and then more discussion about the revision of Tongsik Daoyuk, general education, and they want to revise Chinese history curriculum so that Hong Kong students will only learn all their accomplishments in the 1980s, after the all the great reforms, and nothing before that. And then, of course, we heard about the umbrella movement activists such as Yuen Mei and Long Gaki being threatened to be charged. Mm-hmm. And I also, there was a news about a student who was involved with the umbrella movement being sent back from, I think it's from his hometown. I couldn't remember where, but he was sent back. He was not admitted to I think it's Kunming, that's his birthplace, because he was identified as one of the active students. Oh, so stories like this crop up almost every day. Did not sound very, you know, very good. And then protests were more violent, and people seemed to be getting more radical. In the last 2 days, we heard about recovery of Yuen Long and Chun Wan, and there were so many clashes between Hong Kong people and shoppers from China, and there seemed to be no solution to in place to, you know, to solve the problem. And then we also heard that a third migration wave has emerged amongst the young people, especially. The two earlier waves happened in 1984 and later on 1994 and 1995, and then ending 1997 after the return of Hong Kong to PLC. Now, there seemed to be an emergence of a third immigration wave. And this time, the study was actually focused on the young people, the younger generation. And the finding was that over 60% of these interviewers, the young people, indicated that they were interested to get out of Hong Kong. And what's different this time was that they want to go alone. That's one difference. The other difference is they don't want to go with their family. They just want to have their own experience. They're so tired of what's happening in Hong Kong every day. Destinations are different. In the first two waves, people want to migrate to Canada, Australia, US, all these developed countries. Now, these young people would like to stay in Asia, in Southeast Asia. So they target Taiwan and South Korea. So those are two popular destinations for the younger people. And they were willing to do hard work to establish to establish themselves in this new country, the new host country, and have their own lives through their own experiences. So it's something very new. After, and the finding was actually a very indication of the deep-seated frustration of younger people in general in Hong Kong. Okay, so many bad things. What about good things? There are good things happening. There's support around the world for this movement. Remember there was an Oscar shout out to support the democracy at the awards ceremony for the song Glory by the rapper, as well as by Common. And there are other people. One of my family members who are now on a world trip to celebrate his 50th anniversary carried the banner everywhere. Mm-hmm. and took the picture and then put it on Facebook. Or you then post it at Machu Picchu at Discovery Island. And so it's all over the world. It's this kind of passion as well as commitment to carry the torch forward. That is a very, very promising sign. And there were more and more meaningful discussions of very important issues around rule of law and rule by law, this kind of thing, and what basic law promised us and what the Joint Declaration actually meant for people of Hong Kong. From the British side, what they would, you know, how they can hold this up. All this discussion was much more frequent and more meaningful. And then there was the budget speech, which was also very promising. Our finance head actually advised people to, the young people to stay weird and stay different. And it would actually apply to your home, Hong Kong. You need to stay unique, to stay different in order to survive as a metropolitan. And there was a pretty good funding and support for entrepreneurs, as well, especially technology and entrepreneurs. I think last year he promised that there would be something on the way. And this year, when he made that budget speech a few days ago, he actually mentioned about improving the ecosystem for local startups. And last December, I went to different places and picked up different flyers and see how people will prepare for their future and build their career. And one of the very interesting things is this job fair 2014. For Hong Kong tech and startups. It was very popular, and it was funded by Garage Society, W Hub, but it's also funded by Hong Kong government. So I think Hong Kong government is really genuine in giving some space and also opportunity for the Hong Kong people to build up a future of their own. And I think the government is trying to provide more financing channels and strengthen support services. So John Zhang said that he will ask Hong Kong mortgage corporations to expand and enhance the microfinance schemes. And yesterday I heard that he actually appointed a professor, a CDU professor, to head up the Innovation and Technology Corporation. So there's some very sincere wish on the government part to provide this kind of support for the young people. I think I would like to spend a few minutes to show you actually some of the pictures. Can I have my pictures, please? Yeah. And then before that, sorry. Yeah. before that, as a librarian, I think I still would like to. This one is here. Yeah. This one. Yeah. Archiving and curation of artifacts, data, and memorabilia. And this is very dear to the heart of a retired librarian. When I first saw all the public art, the street arts, as well as all the data available, my interest was who is going to preserve them, curate them, archive them, make it available for prosperity as well as for people interested in the research. So I went back to Hong Kong to through my own network of librarians and friends to find out what they're doing. And I found that no library and no resource center was ready to pick this up. Got something to do with funding. If you want to have a funding for this kind of project, I think you have to work very hard outside and think outside the box. So as far as I know, no library, no museum, resource center are taking this up. But I think it has been well taken care of because there are so many camera wielding crowds and they make a project of their own. For example, Jason Young. Jason Young is an architect, a very famous architect in Hong Kong. And because of the campaign in 75, he said it's the exhibition is called 75 Days in Central. He took so many pictures every day when you walk across the flyover at Lung Lo Do. And he's going to digitize them and then post it up to Facebook for everybody to share. And the other artists such as Perry Dino. Perry Dino is also very famous in Hong Kong. He's a painter, he's an artist and a teacher. So far he painted 22 pictures on site during the campaign. So these are the ways they preserve what they saw. A number of these preservation sites, this is my moment Hong Kong, you have to visit that, it's very cool. Occupy the Hong Kong stand by you, Bing Bin Hang. That's called Bing Bin Hang. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Bing Bin Shang, Jim Jung Da He Ge. Yeah, and then Mr. and Ms. Hong Kong people. And then this UMAP, this Umbrella Movement Art Preservation Project, is all done by volunteers. Another project, UM, the Umbrella Movement Visual Archives and Research Collective, it was headed by a number of academics. They have engaged some volunteer truck drivers, as well as 11 or 12 galleries. So they were willing to pick up the things and rescue whatever need to be rescued on site, and they did that already. And then finally, some of these images already appear in Victoria and Albert Museum in London under Disobedient Objects exhibition. So some of the digitization of our curation project. Okay, yeah. Okay. How many minutes? I just picked five. Okay. Now I want to show you some of the pictures I took in Hong Kong, starting with Central. This is the map of all the ten cities. They call themselves a ten city, different areas. Admiralty South, so all the way along Lung Lo Do and Ha Kwa Do, you can see rows and rows of these tents. And people really take ownership of the space. They look at it as they decorate the place as well as build up a little tent city of their own with a support system as well as schedules for talks, for different exhibitions, different show and tell thing. It's also becoming a tourist hotspot. You see tourists from PLC taking their famous trunk along and then taking pictures. tourists from all over the world, they put up comments, take a sticky notes to express their support or not to be part of the moment. Those are some of the examples of the cartoons, and they came up every day, you know, in thousands. I don't know why they have so much energy and how they could be so efficient in coming up with so many artwork in such a short time. But every single day when something happened, you will see a new batch of cartoon as well as street artwork surfacing, cropping everywhere. This team belongs to Hong Kong U LLB 1999, no longer that young. So they're all very proud of what they are doing. And this, I have to show you this, not showing you my picture, but showing you the public washroom. This is the famous public washroom in Central. Why is it famous? It's so well stocked. You name it. You have suntan lotion, creams, washing, detergent, anything of all kinds of supplies was continuous supply as well to support people who need to stay in the tent for overnight or for 4 days at no ends. It's a very, very famous public washroom. Everything is cleaned out by now, of course, and they have designated cleanse day, November 1st. That's the day to clean up, so everybody will cooperate. And they will also advise you take only what you want, leaving it to other sisters and friends. So they have a strong sense of humor. So if you need something for your skin, here it is. And if you need some suntan lotion, help yourself. And of course, there are posters and sticky notes for different grievances. So this is Central. Now, here is Mong Kok. I took more pictures in Mong Kok. It's a different atmosphere. I took more pictures there because I think few people stay there longer, and there were fewer images to look at. So in a way, they also want to carry on their daily life in Mong Kok, and they have a little worship place for Buddhist worshipper and for Christians, for different kind of religions. So they really regard that place as their own, taking ownership. You see this kind of art creation or protests everywhere. Now, in the distance, you can see that a group of people gather around, and they gather around couches and beds. So they take a nap after a long chat, a long talk, and then cook up some snack. It's just like at home. But here you see fewer younger people. It's more people from all walks of life. Here's Lei Dun Ha Chun. So they also try to name their tents and the places. You know, in a way, that's a protest of the high skyrocketing real estate prices in Hong Kong. So they want to have a piece of land of their own, a home of their own. Okay. So this is kind of slogan. Causeway Bay. Causeway Bay is smaller in scale. Fewer people actually stay overnight, I heard. This is Xi Jinping's cartoon and also some tents below. But what I want to show you is that it is also a hotspot for tourists, for different tourism of kind, shoppers, China shoppers in particular. Okay, so the whole road across Weibei and leading to Wanchai is closed. Okay, now my time is up. It has been a very eventful year in Hong Kong in 2014. During the first wave of the umbrella movement, Hong Kong people occupied the thoroughfare for 79 days, which include hundreds of protesters for real democracy, arrested peacefully and without violence. So I would say keep an eye on what you follow as the next wave of the movement. After consolidation of experience gain and more civil and empowerment in the next half of the year, I think something is going to happen again. Thank you.
Thank you, Eleanor. It's great to get that kind of bird's eye view, personal view, actually from those early days of the movement as well. So,
thank you, ma'am.
So our next speaker is Zoe Lam. Zoe is a PhD candidate in linguistics at UBC, and also one of that younger generation. I mean, she's younger than me. I guess that makes sense. The younger generation. She's younger than Eleanor. But we thought it was very important to kind of actually have someone who really was of the age of many of the protesters, and who was probably not spending a lot of time. Or spending a lot of her time, instead of working on a dissertation, probably keeping track on social media of all the things happening in Hong Kong. And Zoe is also, for those of you who don't know her, someone working on her PhD in basically on Cantonese and the tonal structure. So she's a bit of a term that we sometimes use loosely, a Cantonese chauvinist, and really does believe that Cantonese is an important language and it inextricably tied to Cantonese as a culture, that Hong Kong culture, you could say, is a Cantonese culture. And in many ways, that is a reflection of also the movement. And so Zoe's going to talk a little bit about some of her reflections on language and the kind of movement spaces. So, Zoe Lam.
Thank you, Henry. Good evening, everyone. Today, I just want to talk about space, both in a physical sense and an abstract sense. Because I'm a linguist, I want to talk about linguistic space. So actually, the theme space has been brought up by Hedy and Eleanor as well just now. So I just want to elaborate a little bit. So I actually come to Canada to study. This is my fourth year. So in last December, I had a chance to visit the protest site in Hong Kong. So I got a chance to see the Admiralty site. By the time I was there, I went there, the Mong Kok site was already cleared by the police. So today when I reflect on the Umbrella Revolution, I ask myself certain questions. So the first one is, how has the movement changed Hong Kongers' concept of public space? And how has it changed Hong Kongers' view on how they can use that public space? And then I'll talk about language, which is also about space, but in an abstract sense. So the Umbrella Revolution is also called the Occupy Central Movement. So when we think of the word occupy in English, it's quite neutral. For example, we are occupying this room, but it has no sense that we are capturing this room, right? It doesn't belong to us. We are just here. It's just our location. But if we do the back translation, so the word occupy, when translated to Cantonese, is jim leng. So if we do the back translation, it actually means to capture a space, to own the space, to change the state from not having the ownership of the space to having the ownership of the space. So actually, I think this is significant. And this information is lost in translation in a lot of English media. So if we look at, this is a poster made by netizens. So what it says is that we are not occupying Central. We are recapturing Hong Kong. We want Hong Kong back. So I think this is really important. And there's also a comment here that our ancestor came to Hong Kong to escape from the communists. Don't make us fall victim to communists again. Yeah, so then why? Why? So it assumes that we have lost Hong Kong, and that's why we need to recapture it. So why do Hong Kongers think that they have lost Hong Kong? So to answer this question, we can look at the individual visit scheme, which is a scheme proposed by the Hong Kong government in 2003 to boost tourism in Hong Kong after SARS. So they give tourist visas to mainland Chinese to visit Hong Kong, and they can have multiple entries in a day, I think. Yeah. So there are a lot of tourists, but how many tourists are there? So we can look at some of these numbers. So for example, Japan, let's say Japan is a very popular travel destination, right? So it's very large. If we look at this area, and Hong Kong is just a tiny dot on Google map. So look at the number of mainlanders who visited Hong Kong in 2013. That's 40 million. That's almost four times of the total number of tourists who visited Japan. That's how many tourists there are. So that will help us understand the sentiment of Hong Kongers. Why are they so negative about the incoming tourists? And why do they think that they have lost their city space? So I'm going to show you a lot of pictures. All of them have a lot of people. They look all the same. But the question we need to ask is, who are these people in the picture? So this is taken at the Sheng Shui Station, which is a station near the border, the Hong Kong mainland border. So what you see is that there are a lot of parallel importers, also known as smugglers. So what's happening here is that Hong Kong food and products are known for the safety. So a lot of mainlanders would come to Hong Kong to buy infant formula and like shampoo or other regular things, and then they would sell it in China to earn profit. So these people have a lot of paper boxes because that's all the stuff that they bought from Hong Kong, and they're preparing to cross the border to sell them in China. So this happens every day in Sheng Shui. So imagine we go to Aberdeen Station, or imagine this is Oak Ridge Center or Vancouver City Center. So this is very dangerous because these people have pushed cards, and then it is very easy to hurt yourself. And another thing is there's a lot of garbage on the street because they unpack the goods and distribute it to different smugglers because there's a limited number of cans of infant formula each tourist can take back to China. So this is a very common scene in Hong Kong. And this is also the Sheng Shui Station, and they're carrying a lot of goods to be sold in China. And this is the same. And a problem is these things are very heavy. So imagine everyone's carrying a lot of stuff on the metro trains. Actually, it's not good for the trains because the trains are not supposed to carry such a heavy weight. Yeah, so this is the life of Hong Kongers. And it's not just about the smugglers themselves, but it's also about how it has changed the economy of Hong Kong and the lives of Hong Kongers. So these are all pharmacies. So this is all within one block. So imagine I were an alien who just landed on this planet. I would think that the staple food of this species is infant formula. This is how many pharmacies there are in Mong Kok. And so this is the Mong Kok area. This is a Google search. If I search pharmacy, this is my result. So do we really need that many pharmacies? So the question is, the shops on the street are no longer serving the local people. So the whole economy has become strange and abnormal. Yeah. So this already happened before the Umbrella Revolution happened. So how has the Umbrella Revolution changed Hong Kongers' concept of public space? So in the past, I would think that Hong Kongers don't really care about their public space. The public space is just somewhere for you to pass by. When you need to get from point A to point B, you need to pass by that space, and that's it. But after the Umbrella Revolution, I think Hong Kongers have the sense that this space belongs to us, and we need to take it back. And we can also do something creative in order to take back that space. And there is a good example of this creative use of public space during the Lunar New Year, which is just 2 weeks ago. So I'll give you a little bit of background. So two things. First, street food is very important to Hong Kongers, like fish balls and I don't know how to call those in English, but yeah, street food is very important for Hong Kongers. And another thing is during Lunar New Year, the first 3 days of Lunar New Year are usually public holidays in Hong Kong, which means that the staff from the food and environmental hygiene department will not arrest the unlicensed street food vendors. So that has been the practice over the years. It has always been like that. So what you see during Lunar New Year is that in the evening, you'll see a lot of street food. And they are all run by unlicensed street food vendors. And actually, local people love it. But this year, it is different. So after the Umbrella Revolution, basically the police are afraid of seeing a big crowd lingering on the streets. So they don't want to see this. And they actually sent inspectors from Food and Environmental Hygiene Department to arrest the unlicensed street food vendors. So what the Hong Kongers did is that they tried to protect the food vendors. So they tried to hold hands to form a barricade, and then they stopped the inspectors from arresting the street food vendors. And this is Mong Kok, which is the district with a lot of pharmacies. Yeah, and this is also Mong Kok, and these are all Hong Kongers. And so these are the people trying to protect the street food vendors. So the significance of this is that after the Umbrella Revolution, Hong Kongers' comfort zone is getting bigger. They feel that they can use disobedience to keep their local culture. They cherish their street food. It is important to them. So they do something about it. Because I would imagine before the Umbrella Revolution, Hong Kongers would not do this. They would just stand on the side and watch. That's just my personal feeling. But after the Umbrella Revolution, they actually believe that they can do something when they don't agree with the practice of government representatives. They can do something about it. So we can watch some videos. Yep, so these are the people from the Food and Environmental Hygiene Department, and then the local people just ask them to go away. Stop disturbing us. We want our street food. And then the inspectors had to go because of the pressure from the local people. Yeah, so remember, these people are just strangers to each other. They just happen to be on that street at that time. So they're not friends or anything. But at that moment, they all have the same goal, to ask the inspectors to go away. So I think this is definitely an effect of the Umbrella Revolution. Yeah, so I just talked about physical space, and now I'm going to move to something more abstract, which is the linguistic space. And I'll talk about three keywords. The first one is gaowu, which is a new word coined from the Umbrella Revolution. It's a completely new word. And second is the name of Hong Kong. How do we call this city? And the third is how do we call that place across the border? Is it China or mainland? Yeah. So the first word I want to talk about is gaowu. So gaowu, as I mentioned here, it means shopping, but it's not that simple. So a little bit of background. Before the Umbrella Revolution actually happened, when people were planning for the Occupy Central movement, there was actually an anti-Occupy protest. And the participants were believed to be paid by pro-Beijing political parties. So cable TV interviewed one of the participants in that anti-Occupy protest. And this lady replied in accented Cantonese. So the reporter asked, "Why are you here today?" So she answered in Cantonese, "Oh, I came to Hong Kong." And then suddenly she didn't know how to say shopping in Cantonese, so she switched to Mandarin and she said, "Go Wu." So Go Wu is shopping in Mandarin. So we can watch that video.
In Cantonese?
So she didn't know how to say shopping in Cantonese, so she switched to Mandarin in the interview. Yep, so a lot of netizens made fun of this, and then they made this word called Go Wu. And also the chief executive of Hong Kong, CY Leung, encouraged people to shop in the protest districts to boost the economy and something like that. So a lot of protesters want to respond to this call and they want to go shopping in the district and the protest sites. So as I said, Go Wu is Mandarin, is the Mandarin pronunciation for shopping. In Cantonese, when we want to say shopping, it's actually a different word, is ma ye. So if we take, so I should explain this. This is quite complicated linguistically. So go wu, when we transcribe it in Cantonese, we get these two characters. And actually each of these characters has its own meaning. So like gao is a bird, but it's also homophonous. It also sounds like a swear word. And wu is just the noise of a crow. So when the two words are put together, it's actually nonsense. It actually doesn't mean anything. But go wu as a word has captured the Mandarin pronunciation for shopping. So if we take these two characters and read them in Mandarin, it doesn't make any sense to Mandarin speakers. So the significance of this is that Hong Kongers made a new word to make fun of that protester, of the anti-Occupy protest. And they also drew a boundary because Mandarin speakers, when they read these two characters, they don't understand it. So this is to draw the boundary between Cantonese users and Mandarin users. And this word gao wu has an extended use, so it doesn't just mean shopping, but it also means to linger in the public space for some reason. For example, holding yellow umbrellas, shouting slogans for genuine universal suffrage. So there's this flash mob called gao wu tun, which means shopping tour. Yeah, so this word has a robust use in the language. So we can make new words based on this word gao wu, like we have gao wu tun. And these are just people who read messages on online forums and they respond to the messages. Oh, let's gather at this street at this time, bring your yellow umbrellas. So these people don't really know each other. They just read the messages online and they show up. And this is the new word, gao wu tun. So it's not just young people. And this is, I'm coming to Gao Wu, do not beat me up. Yeah, so this is to say, I'm just here for shopping. I'm just responding to the call of the chief executive. So don't use violence. Yeah. And this is similar. So this flag was actually used by the police during the Umbrella Revolution, so stop charging or we'll shoot or we use tear gas. Yeah, so the local people use that same idea to say, we support the chief executive, I come to Mong Kok to shop till I drop, and then and police, please give way. Yeah. And we also have signs like this. So this is from the Lunar New Year market just 2 weeks ago. And it says, 立即 gao wu, so shop immediately or get beaten up in the dark. So this is a response to the incident in which some protesters were beaten up by the police in the dark. And the netizens even made new videos based on this work, new word, Gawu, and they rewrote the lyrics of a really popular song sung by Andy Lau. And the title of that song is Yat Yat Ho Gawu. That means I go shopping every day. Shopping every day. And you can see this wolf in the middle, it's a symbol for the chief executive, and he has a lot of paperbacks on his hand, so he's shopping as well. Yeah. So this is how Gawu is used. And the significance of this is that Mandarin is treated as a foreign language because this word Gawu is adapted into Cantonese with characters that don't make sense when being put together. So if we look at these examples of loanword adaptation from English, so like taxi becomes taxi, and if we just take these two characters individually, tick has as its own meaning, C has its own meaning, but when they're put together, actually it doesn't mean anything. It's just a transcription of the English pronunciation. So it's the same for strawberry, sidobele. And if we look at gawu, it's very similar. So we take a word from Mandarin, and then we just transcribe the Mandarin pronunciation with Cantonese characters. So the important thing here is that Mandarin is treated as a foreign language, just like English or French. And this is a rare case. Yeah. In the past, we would just use the character and put quotation marks around it. So this is definitely something new. And the second thing I want to talk about is the name of the city, Hong Kong. So if I digress a little bit to talk about the Indian city, Mumbai. So actually before it was called Bombay, but because Bombay has the sense of the British legacy, so it's changed to Mumbai, which is closer to the local vernacular. So the direction is from something not local to local. But we can see that recently the city of Hong Kong is called Xiang Gang in several occasions. So the direction is going from the local name to a Mandarin name. Yeah, so this is a sign in China, which is understandable because the users on the road may not know Hong Kong means Xiang Gang. So it's understandable that they use the Mandarin transcription. But we found that on Encyclopedia Britannica, Hong Kong was put as Xiang Gang, and a lot of netizens became really angry, and they wrote a lot of emails to request change. Yeah, so it's the same for FIFA World Cup. Yeah, and this is the application for the master's program in Chinese University of Hong Kong, and it's put as Xiang Gang instead of Hong Kong. And that's why a lot of netizens react very strongly. So this says Hong Kong is Hong Kong, not Xiang Gang. So what we are trying to defend our name in Cantonese. Yeah. And the last thing is how we call China. Do we call it China or mainland? So actually the phrase Zhonggong, which is China hyphen Hong Kong, has been used in many occasions, documents. Even there's a shopping mall called Zhonggong Xing. But recently, the government announced, it's really recent, February 18th, the government announced that on government documents, we have to say mainland-Hong Kong relations, but not China-Hong Kong relations. So in short, what Hong Kongers are trying to do is a blue arrow. So we are trying to draw the space, draw a boundary. So this is what Hong Kongers want to do from this picture on the left to the picture on the right. But what the Hong Kong government wants to do is the other way around. So this is how the Umbrella Revolution changed Hong Kongers' idea of space, both in physical sense and linguistic sense. Thank you.
We have some time for...
It would be wonderful if we had like till 11 o'clock tonight just to keep talking about so many of the ideas that came out tonight. We have some time for a couple questions, about 5-10 minutes for questions, and so just open it up for the audience as well as if you want to ask each other. But, many different times. Or you don't want to ask anything, that's also possible. But Leo,
of course, these are wonderful talks, and I appreciate all the images and photos and videos and music, and all those are wonderful things. I was just struck by the references to Hong Kongers, right, Hong Kong people. And obviously, there are many varieties and many versions of Hong Kongers. And they responded, and they have responded to the umbrella movement quite differently, by generations, by occupations, by social classes. So, so how did that fit into the talks? Meaning that, obviously, they didn't all respond in the same way. So how would you comment on the diversity and differences between different kinds of Hong Kongers?
Well, let me start first. I have to say that it is very, very difficult to give a sense of shape to that movement, especially from my perspective, and because I'm here teaching something very Western, but it's also very difficult because we are only very one-sided. What kind of argument we craft depends on what kind of information we get and where we get the information. So, right? And it's really about new media and old media and how we select to attract that space. And so I can tell you something very, very, very interesting. And so at the beginning of the movement, Hong Kong people become quickly polarized. My mom stopped talking to me, for example. I'm the eldest of four, and the four of us, we all were very, very sympathetic with the protesters. And because we understand what it means to be a university student, we understand that, oh my goodness, you know, you want to save. So many of my friends are still trying to save for their mortgage, and this is kind of, you know, there's no way they can save for a mortgage, right? And so, but my mom and my dad, they're retired. They don't want, well, they have money, but they don't want to spend money and buy newspapers every day. They think this is a waste of their money. My dad, for example, he's 74. Where did he get his news? He gets his news from television, state media, okay? So they all quickly, they just call the umbrella movement a riot, very quickly, like immediately. And my mom stopped talking to me instantly. So therefore, we can just see that. I think I want to redefine the question, not from the perspective of middle class or lower class, but from the way they get the information, okay? My mom and my dad have no access to social media. And that's too complicated for them. They don't even know how to have a Facebook account. And so therefore, when my dad switched on, he read China's Daily, for example. So, oh, this is all bad. And he never goes out. So therefore, the concept of space becomes very, very complex. Because if you don't go out too much, you know, to those protest sites, and you get the news only from the state media, you know, every day, and at 6:30, you hear the Chinese answering national anthem. How do we call it? Your media space, I would say, becomes so manipulated, okay, by those who pay for the media. Okay, so I think the concept of space will be very, very evocative. And so for me, I don't reach People's Daily. That kind of, you know, makes me angry. And so therefore I get my news. We all get our news from Apple Daily, you know, and so from all the other sites, and from Facebook, or from Denise Ho's Facebook page. So therefore, we have a very, very different sense of the umbrella revolution. And we know that, okay, none of the things that we're interested in will be reported kind of, you know, officially. So therefore, we have to take the responsibility to kind of archive those things on our own. So therefore, very, very quickly, we kind of construct our own story of what umbrella revolution should be or was to us. So therefore, it's very, very hard to get a sense of the whole from an objective sense. So that's how I would respond to that.
Well, this umbrella movement is a movement with no leaders. Most of the actions and the decisions were made spontaneously, and that was one of the weaknesses of the movement. As a student-led movement, it's not even academic-led anymore in a later stage. So I think by its very nature, it will be very divergent. The opinions will be very divergent. My host family have a Sing Dao delivered to their home every day. So I just keep on reminding myself, don't talk about Yu San Wen Dong. Don't talk about movement at that home. They will kick me out. They were so nice to me. So very, very different opinions. And yet, this is all part of Hong Kong. And that's why I'm so pleased to see, I used to be a librarian, so always look for books, so many good publications coming out right away, after 2 months. Zhui San or this kind of Qi Qi Jiu, and it's stories of 500 people who were actively involved in this on both sides, the blue and the yellow side. And you need to be quite intensively colorblind to understand and appreciate what really happened. So.
I think Hong Kong is definitely not a homogenous group in terms of political stance. So in the past, I think it's just pro-government and pro-democracy. But I think after the Umbrella Revolution, there's a clearer picture. Among the pro-democracy group, there are different, like subtly different groups. And I think they have always been different, but they didn't make it so explicit. I think it's until the Umbrella Revolution, they had to make it really explicit to enlist support from different Hong Kongers.
Yeah, I was there too. I was staying at Admiralty Center leading up to the Umbrella Revolution. And what I tried to do leading up to it was speak to as wide range of people as possible to see how they felt about it leading up to it. And actually, as it happened, I spoke to the young, the teenagers, the students, CEOs, pop song writers. How I would categorize, even though it's not scientific, is that a lot of it was self-interest. Economically, you benefit from China. The CEOs, the pop song writers who sold to China, they were against the Umbrella Revolution. Others who were more ideological, more for the universal suffrage and for freedom of speech, common law, internet, so forth, were more for it. But there's also a third element, I felt. Whether you were a student or whether you were a CEO or someone who benefited, it was beyond the ideology. They understood West versus where was China come from and how the world, in terms of the undeveloping countries, are starting to be more powerful in terms of how they impress what they want on the world, both in terms of economics, culture, in terms of fashion, in terms of art, music, you name it. That movement, they felt, was unstoppable. So whether they benefited from it or not, they saw that as inevitable, and they settled to basically agree to it. And they felt there was no point fighting it. So I found that element, too, among both young and old, among that element who understood that huge wave of how the world's changing today compared to what it was like even just 20 years ago.
Thanks. I'm going to keep going, but thanks for that. It's an interesting observation. I think Paul, you had a question. Maybe anybody else, and we can take a couple last ones. But
here.
Oh. Sorry. Okay, how about, you didn't have one, Paul? No? Okay, one, two, and then three maybe, and then we'll have to sort of wrap up the room. Yeah, one, two, three, four.
All right.
Okay, so there's four of you.
I was over there too. I was a visiting prof at CU all through the fall, so I was in the streets a lot and talking to different faculty members and students at CU. And I would echo some of the comments that have been made. There's a tremendous diversity of opinion, but it's even more complex than that because, I mean, I had lunch with a young student who was sleeping in, you know, on the streets every night. And talked to her about it, and she was conflicted in terms of, you know, what could be achieved. Why were they even there? She was self-critical, you know, she examined herself and her own motives. Is this just ideals? Am I being naive or romantic? Is, you know, what can we do in the end anyway? Is it all pointless? And I talked to a former chair of philosophy who was rallying behind the students and out there supporting them. I talked to the former chair of chemistry, a Hong Kong person, grew up, born, raised in Hong Kong, who was really they're not too happy with the students. He felt it was really brave of them to step forward, but they should really work within the law. That was his point. We have a legal framework. Work with that. So it is complicated, even for individuals. And then another thing is, I did some radio interviews from there through Skype, and the big focus was that trying to frame this in terms of pro-democracy, you know, position the PRC as the opposition in all of this, but missing other dimensions, which I heard some of you comment on, and that is the economic side. The broader neoliberal agenda, the shifting world economies, so that there's a tremendous polarization in terms of income. Income disparity is growing, right? And young people in Hong Kong know that. And I talked to Prof who said, you know, God help them, how are they going to get jobs? How are they going to get a place to live? You know, these are scary things for these students. And they're living with it. So it's partly about that too. And then the Hong Konger. What is a Hong Konger? Where did that come from? The Brits were quite authoritarian, I would say. They had an agenda which was largely economic. The Hong Konger is something of an invention, I would say, going back to the 70s. That before the early 60s and before that, people were from the village. It was the village they identified with, you know, their home payment, wherever they came from. They had their own sense of identity that linked them across that border. That was changed through the 70s and 80s, you know, industry, and then the movement away from to post-industrial economy. So it's even the idea of what a Hong Konger is, or a Hong Kong Yen, you know, Hong Kong Yen. Sorry about the tones. So anyway, I'll stop now, but this is all rattling around in my head. It's quite confusing.
Thanks, Paul.
Joanne? Yeah, I agree with Paul. I remember when I was young, going to elementary school, and even in high school too, every time I have to fill out any information for the school, I have to write down the village where my father came from. But as I grew older, go to university later, and that disappeared. I want to say that I find Zoe's presentation very interesting, especially Chen Dongwu. But I want to share with you that when I first saw this term on the daily, Apple Daily, those videos, it took me some time to understand it. But then I agree with you that the terms, the two words has their own, the words have their its own meaning, and when you combine the two together, it doesn't make sense. But however, it actually creates an image in my mind. Right after I saw that, I actually saw a flock of birds coming together crying for a situation in Hong Kong. So I think, you know, that has some meaning, you know, for the creation of that term. Yeah. And I also want to share my experience with Heidi about not talking to family about, you know, this movement. Yeah, my family and I always talk about it since that happened. But I think I stopped talking to them. I stopped talking to them, especially to my sister, after I actually saw her on the TV. She was actually, she was for the government, and she was in her department head's vehicle. And she was blocked by the people. She can't go into the office. Mm-hmm. It was very difficult for me to see her on TV in that situation, and it's a video actually. And I started to feel that it was also very difficult for her to talk about her own experience or even to comment on her work or the situation. So I guess from then on, we stopped talking. We are still not talking yet. Yeah.
Cassie, and then.
So when I first, I came in late, and maybe I missed part of the talk, and I think, thank you for all three presenters. I think you gave me a perspective that I never had before. So I grew up in mainland China. I grew up in Beijing, and I came to Canada when I was 16 years old. And I don't know about Hong Kong very well at all. I've never been there, and all the things I know about is what I heard from television and what you talk about, you know, the media in mainland China is probably true, because the media center is very intense. Like, I never felt that until reason why I went back to China, you know, 6 years after I lived in Canada, and it is something that I wish could change in the future. But I got a little bit defensive halfway through the part of the talk when I was here for. And I think the part where I felt really defensive is because the argument became Hong Kong versus New Guinea, and I don't think it is the case. Because if you think about all the people in Hong Kong, mainland China, they're not that different to begin with. I mean, you have all the social classes, you have all the minorities, and people in China, the minorities are not suffering less than people in Hong Kong, I think. And I know that my views might be biased, and it probably is, and what I remember, as young as I was in 1997, that's not what the Chinese government taught us. That's not what everybody believed, that when Hong Kong was returned to China, we were thinking that it will be a reunion. It will be, you know, it will be a place that's returned back to its home country. And we did not think, you know, like, oh, now it's time to, you know, like, take advantage of this place that's well developed, and, you know, all the people will just go into Hong Kong and just start smuggling. I think we forgot that these people are under the same pressure from the same government that, you know, is giving so much pressure to the Hong Kong commoners. And I think we're missing a bigger argument here. It's not just between Hong Kong and China, and we need to bring it further, one step further. We need to look deeper into this issue. I think the connection between Hong Kong and mainland China, or if you say Hong Kong and China, it doesn't matter what term we use, it's not going to stop. The connection will not stop, never stopped, even when Hong Kong was part of the British Empire, or even before that. And then if you think of it culturally, historically, the connection has never stopped, but how do we make both of Hong Kong and mainland China better? Like, I think sometimes we're just so focused, and I hear the other side of the arguments. I have many friends who are like me. They grew up in mainland China, and they're very, very emotional, and they also feel very defensive about this because, you know, like, sometimes the way that mainlanders are portrayed in Hong Kong media, it just makes us feel like we're less than human. We're not getting any respect from people, and I feel really defensive being, you know, I identify myself as Chinese, a mainland Chinese. It doesn't matter how my citizenship would change, and I, you know, it's one of us, it's one of my people, and why are we treated like that, like we're just less than everybody else? We're not. I mean, and I'm pretty sure that's not what most people would think. I mean, you would feel that you are threatened by a lot of the, you call it smugglers, or, you know, like shoppers from mainland China who are, you know, just flooding into Hong Kong. But is there a better way to deal with that? Because they are not, you know, just some kind of abnormality in the society. It reflects part of society. And I think one thing we don't know is what would happen if Hong Kong would not return to China. Will it be any different? We don't know that. And there's no way we'll know. And I think the fact that Hong Kong and mainland China are together in many senses is a great opportunity for us to think of how we can work together instead of working against each other. Because after all, we are in the same boat, and if the boat sinks, we all do, and we're in a global economy where, you know, people cannot be, like, countries and countries cannot be separated from each other. And localizing, you know, like, we're just rejecting mainland Chinese as foreigners or, you know, something. I don't think that will help in anything. And if anything that living in Canada has taught me is that when you think of the social inequalities were inequalities in any place. It's not localized. It's universal. And it reflects some universal theme that's present in every society, in every country. And I think it's time for us to step up and just really look beyond what's happening in Hong Kong and think of what we can really do to make it better for everybody, not just people in Hong Kong, not just people in mainland China.
First of all, thank you, Hedy, for the very stimulating
talk. Well, I want to actually thank Denise and Lisa and others who, and Angela, who did put together the talk.
And thank you for all three of you to give us a very stimulating and thought-provoking talk.
My name is Fenella Sun, and I belong to a local group here in Vancouver called Friends of Hong Kong. I think one striking aspect to me about the umbrella movement is how international and how globalized it is. But I think I would like to throw this out to seek the views of the three speakers tonight. Like when it first started, we see to hear the people sing the lament. Like we see the occupy movement concept. It's all very international, all globalized. And even the idea of civil disobedience, it's not local, but on the other hand, you see the Hong Kong identity, so strong, so powerful, coming out of this globalization, this global concept. So we can see a very distinct Hong Kong identity there. On one hand, you're very international, you're very globalized, but on the other hand, you put all these things together. Given the history and the background of Hong Kong, then you come up, those kind of things came out. And I just would like to respond a little bit to your comment. Yes, on a personal level, I really see where you're coming from. And I think, you know, I bring feedback about the situation, about all these shoppers and all these things. Actually, I felt for them too, when they were heckled and things like that. It's not their fault. But unfortunately, it's their government's fault. It's the government that put people against each other, that put the Hong Kong people against the mainland Chinese people. And I think this is the term that all of us here in Canada, we're so privileged here, that we can think, we can have a shift level, that we can put out of all this, that we can think of a very constructive way and creative way how to work together to help Hong Kong, to help China. Thank you.
Well, that may be actually a good last word. Thanks so much. I think, I want to thank Angela and Lisa and Denise for really actually putting this together. I think there's been a lot of things that came up, and in fact, I think what was so interesting to, again, as the moderator, was how passionate, I mean, not just the speakers who, you know, shared their thoughts on looking back, but also, you know, in the audience, and, you know, I wish we had more and more time to actually talk about this, because what is clear is that this was one of the most pivotal moments, you could say, in Hong Kong history. You could name many of the moments back since they became a colony of the British, but this was clearly a pivotal moment, whether it's a revolution in the Hana Ren sense or a turning point or this or that. I mean, clearly it's been really interesting tonight to kind of look back and think about what was its significance. I think this is not the only kind of moment to do that, but I'm glad we're able to tonight actually just kind of assess looking back. So thank you to Hedy and to Eleanor and to Zoe for kind of helping start that conversation about looking back. Welcome you to keep talking in the room and also